Hi, children. Thanks for watching today. The stories that I'm going to read for you were originally written in the 6th century by a slave in Egypt named Aesop. Well, now we're in the 21st century, so you see how old these stories are. And then in the 17th century, a man named Le Marquis de La Fontaine wrote his own version of these same stories in French. What I'm going to read to you today is in translation. And these stories often had a moral. They had a lesson. And the lesson was often about the bad quality of being envious. Now, envy is a feeling that you get when somebody else has something that you like. And you don't just say, well, I'm going to ask for that for my birthday or for Christmas, or I'm going to earn some money and buy one myself. No, envy is a feeling, is a very bad feeling you get when you want the thing the other person has, or you think that they don't deserve it, but you do. And it's a very troubling feeling. Another lesson that La Fontaine and Aesop taught people was not to be prideful. Now, it's fine to be proud of yourself, but not to think that you're better than other people or that you have talents that you really don't possess. So then you can get into a lot of trouble. And we're going to see both lessons in this first story. And this is the frog who wished to be as big as the ox. There was a little frog whose home was in a bog, and he worried because he wasn't big enough. He sees an ox and cries, well, that's just about my size. If I stretch myself, say, sister, see me puff? And there he is with his sister. There's the ox, and he's puffing and puffing, trying to make himself as big as an ox. So he blew, saying, sister, will that do? But she shook her head, and then he lost his wits, for he stretched and puffed again till he cracked beneath the strain and burst and flew about in little bits. And there's the tragedy. So he came to a very bad end, and there's a little elf reading about a lesson of envy from the Book of Envy. The Grasshopper and the Ant. The grasshopper singing all summer long, and here we see him with the sheet music. He's got a harp. Now found winter stinging and ceased in his song. Not a morsel or crumb in his cupboard, so he shivered and ceased in his song. Miss Ant was his neighbor. To her he went. Oh, you're rich from labor, and I've not a cent. Lend me food, and I vow I'll return it, though at present I have not a cent. Well, let's see. The ant doesn't look too impressed, does she? And if you notice, the grasshopper's on crutches. I don't know if he really needs those crutches or if he wanted the ant to feel sorry for him. I don't know, but look at all the food she's got. And she's at a butter churn. Now, years ago, many, many years ago, that was the way butter was made. It was put in one of these oaken baskets and sort of beaten with a stick up and down, and it turned into butter. The ant's not a lender, I must confess. Her heart's far from tender to one in distress. So she said, pray, how passed you the summer that in winter you come to distress? I sang through the summer, Grasshopper said, but now I am glummer because I've no bread. So you sang, sneered the ant. Oh, that relieves me. Now it's winter. Go dance for your bread. And so there he is. He's headed to the poorhouse. He's still got his crutches and his harp. And there's the moral of the story. From the point of view of the ant, he who will not work shall not eat. The dog and his image. A foolish dog who carried in his jaw a juicy bone looked down into a stream, and there he saw another one. See, he's looking at his reflection. And he's fooled by it. Splash! In he plunged. The image disappeared. The meat he had was gone. Indeed, he nearly sank and barely reached the bank. There he's jumping in, looking for that bone. And here he's just making it up onto the bank. There we go. And now he has a dunce cap. Now, some of you children might not know what a dunce cap is. A very long time ago in school, if a child behaved badly or just didn't learn his lesson, they would put them, and this is true, this is the way it was. They were put into a corner, facing the corner, and they would wear a hat just like this hat we see on the dog. It was a hat like a cone, and it said dunce. A dunce meant someone who was stupid, stupid and knew nothing. So things were very different then in school. The Raven and the Fox. Mr. Raven was perched upon a limb, and Reynard the Fox looked up at him. And it looks like that fox has a piece of cheese. And he's very big. The Raven has the piece of cheese that the fox wants. And you may say, gee, that's an unusual name, Reynard. Well, in French, renard means fox. And so most people think of these fables as being the French version. And La Fontaine called the fox renard, and here in English it's reynard. For the raven held in his great big beak a morsel the fox would go far to seek. See, there it is. There they are. Said the fox in admiring tones, "My word, Sir Raven, you are a handsome bird. Such feathers! If you would only sing, the birds of these woods would call you king." The raven, who did not see the joke, forgot that his voice was just a croak. He opened his beak in his foolish pride, and down fell the morsel the fox had spied. "Ha, ha," said the fox, "and now you see you should not listen to flattery." "Vanity, sir, is a horrid vice. I'm sure the lesson is worth the price." And there you see the raven is singing against the moon, and the moon is smiling in the background. The City Mouse and the Country Mouse. And here they are. And the Country Mouse has a scarf, and he's got an umbrella in his bag. He's coming into the city, which you can see the buildings in the background there. And the City Mouse wears a collar just like a gentleman. A City Mouse with ways polite, a Country Mouse invited to sup with him and spend the night. Said Country Mouse, delighted. In truth, it proved a royal treat, with everything that's good to eat. Alas, when they had just begun to gobble their dinner, a knock was heard that made them run. The City Mouse seemed thinner. And as they scampered and turned tail, he saw the Country Mouse grow pale. Now there they are, when they're hearing the noise. They're hearing the knock, and look at them. They're right there in the middle of a cake that's been cut, and there are cherries and fruit, and you can see it's nighttime. You can see the stars through the curtains. And there's the Country Mouse running, and it looks like a cherry fell off the table. The knocking ceased, a false alarm. The City Mouse grew braver. "Come back," he cried. "No, no, no, no." Now this, children, you can see is a different kind of a drawing. It looks, and you see that line down the center. Well, that's from a very old book that's been opened flat. So whoever put this together decided to use some illustrations from an older book as well. Now, this is a different part of the table, obviously. There's their having their cheese and crackers. And there goes, there they go, scampering and running off the table. The farm where I'll not quake or quaver suits me, replied the country mouse. You're welcome to your city house. And there he is, he's back home, and he's perfectly content to be there. The dove and the ant. An ant again. An ant who in a brook would drink fell off the bank. He tried to swim and felt his courage sink. But look who came to the rescue. There's a dove with a bit of grass for the ant to catch onto. I don't know if you can see the ant there, but you can see the concentric circles where the ant is struggling to keep his head above water. This ocean seemed so wide, but for a dove who flew above, he would have drowned and died. The friendly dove within her beak, a bridge of grass stem bore. On this the ant, though worn and weak, contrived to reach the shore. Said he, the tact of this kind act I'll cherish evermore. Behold, a barefoot wretch went by with slingshot in his hand. Said he, you'll make a pigeon pie that will be kind of grand. So he wanted to kill the dove. You can see the dove is right there above the pond. And you see there's somebody's boat there. And that box hanging from the tree is a creel. That's what fishermen use to keep the fish that they catch in. It's called a creel. He meant to murder the gentle bird who did not understand. The ant then stung him on the heel. Now, you may not think of ants as stingers, but some kinds of ants can really sting and bite you. The ant then stung him on the heel so quick to see the sling. He turned his head and missed a meal. The pigeon pie took wing. And so the dove lived on to love, beloved by everything. And that's Latin that you see there, children. Amor vincit, means love conquers. The fox and the grapes. Rosy and ripe and ready to box, that is, ready to put in a box, the grapes hang high o'er the hungry fox. So there he is looking at the grapes, and his tongue is hanging out. He pricks up his ear, and his eye he cocks. And when you cock your eye, you kind of focus. You're kind of narrowing your eye and kind of trying to see more clearly. Ripe and rosy, yet so high, he gazes at them with a greedy eye and knows he must eat and drink or die. And again, that's one of those drawings from that old book that this person used in his book. And there are the grapes, and he's looking up with his tongue hanging out. When the jump proves to be beyond his power, poo, says the fox, let the pigs devour fruit of that sort. Those grapes are sour. So, were the grapes sour, children? Well, we don't know. But probably not. But the fox wanted to console himself for not getting what he wanted. So he tried to convince himself that, well, they weren't any good anyway. And you often hear people nowadays say that, someone has sour grapes, which means they pretend that they don't really want something that they actually do want but can't have. So there's the pigs eating the grapes. They don't look too displeased. The fox and the stork. Now, the foxes were, in these stories, Aesop's and La Fontaine's fables, were known for their being wise and clever and sly. And to this day, that's the characteristic that people apply to foxes. Old Father Fox, who was known to be mean, invited Dame Stork into dinner. And there she is looking at the invitation. I don't know if you can see, children, but it says RSVP at the bottom. Now, that means in French, répondez s'il vous plaît. And to this day, all over the world, that's what people use when they want you to answer an invitation and let them know if you're coming. There was nothing but soup that could scarcely be seen. Soup never was served any thinner. And the worst of it was, as I'm bound to relate, Father Fox dished it up on a flat china plate. Dame Stork, as you know, has a very long beak. Not a crumb or drop could she gather, had she pecked at the plate every day in the week. You can see she's angry, and it's the fox is watching her, and he's licking up the soup and kind of having a good time. But as for the fox, sly old father, with his tongue lapping soup at a scandalous rate, he licked up the last bit and polished the plate. Pretty soon Mr. Stork spread a feast of her own. Father Fox was invited to share it. He came and he saw, and he gave a great groan. The stork had known how to prepare it. She had meant to get even, and now it was her turn. Father Fox was invited to eat from an urn, which, of course, as you see, he can't do. And Dame Stork is laughing, and the fox is frustrated and annoyed. The urn's mouth was small and it had a long neck. The food in it smelled most delightful. Dame Stork, with her beak in, proceeded to peck. But the fox found that fasting is frightful. Home he sneaked. On his way there, he felt his ears burn when he thought of the stork and her tall, tricky urn. There he's thinking about what happened. You see, he played a trick on the stork, but he didn't have the last laugh. The stork had the last laugh. The hare, another very famous one, the hare and the tortoise. And here they are, planning something. They're discussing their competition. They're going to have a race. Said the tortoise one day to the hare, "I'll run you a race if you dare. I'll bet you cannot arrive at that spot as quickly as I can get there." Quoth the hare, "You are surely insane. Pray, what has affected your brain? You seem pretty sick. Call a doctor in quick and let him prescribe for your pain." "Never mind," said the tortoise. "Let's run. Will you bet me?" "Why, certainly. Done." While the slow tortoise creeps, Mr. Hare makes four leaps and then loafs around in the sun. It seemed such a one-sided race. To win was almost a disgrace. So he frolicked about. Then at last he set out as the tortoise was nearing the place. Too late. And there he's looking at an hourglass, which is a very, very old way to measure time. There was just enough sand in one end of the hourglass with two glasses with a little narrow space in between. And when the sand ran out, it was all fixed and arranged. So when the sand ran out from the top glass into the bottom one, an hour had passed, or maybe 2 hours, or a number of minutes, however it had been designed, however long they knew it would take for the sand to run down into the other glass. Too late, though he sped like a dart, the tortoise was first, she was smart. "You can surely run fast," she remarked, "yet you're last. It is better to get a good start." And there it is, and the The hare looks kind of shocked, and that the tortoise has triumphed, has won. And here, this looks like the coat of arms of the tortoise. Now, a coat of arms many years ago was a symbol of a family. And it would be something that looked like this, and when people saw it, they would recognize that that belonged to that particular family. The heron who was hard to please. A long-legged heron with long neck and beak set out for a stroll by the bank of a creek. So clear was the water that if you looked sharp, you could see the pike caper around with the carp. The heron might quickly have speared enough fish to make for his dinner a capital dish, but he was a very particular bird. His food fixed just so at the hours he preferred, and hence he decided 'twas better to wait, since his appetite grew when he supped rather late. Pretty soon he was hungry and stalked to the bank, where some pond fish were leaping, a fish of low rank. "Bah, bah," said the bird. "Sup on these? No, not I." There's his pride, you see. "I'm known as a heron, as such I live high." Then some gudgeons swam past that were tempting to see, but the heron said haughtily, "No, no, not for me. For those I'd not bother to open my beak if I had to hang round come next Friday a week." Thus bragged the big bird. He's bound to confess that he opened his elegant beak for much less. Not another fish came. When he found all else fail, he was happy to happen upon a fat snail. So there's the fish that he didn't want. And here he is eating a snail. That was all he could get at that point. And there's just a little drawing here. Today, snails à la Gaston. You know, in many parts of the world, people eat snails. Some people eat them in the United States, too. And they cook them right in the shell, and they eat them out of the shell. Well, children, I think that's all we have time for. I hope you enjoyed the stories. You've been watching Stories to Explore on Norfolk Public Access. I'm Anne Marie Battistone, and we'll see you next time.